Here is the dinking segment of this course. The term dinking means you want to hit the ball soft into your opponent's kitchen. That forces them to have to hit up. You know, another term we can use is you want to try to hit a non-attackable soft ball that's in front of your opponent that forces them to have to hit up. But the whole philosophy behind dinking is keeping the ball soft into your opponent's kitchen, forcing them to try to hit the ball up. So it gives you a pop-up. On that pop-up, you can put the pop-up away. Newer players coming in, I totally get it. Everybody wants to hit the ball hard, and I guarantee that you can win a lot of points at a lower level with hitting the ball hard. As we watch higher level pickleball, we see the game actually slow down a lot. Everybody's dinking a lot more. Everybody's keeping the ball down. So obviously, if they're doing it at a higher level, we should be doing it at a lower level. But it takes a select skill set to be able to control the ball soft into your opponent's kitchen. So a couple of the key mechanics we're going to talk a lot about today as we get dinking is focusing on being in the correct grip, which is that continental grip. We're going to talk a lot about using our shoulder. I like to focus on like the shoulder doing all the work and then connecting my legs with my shoulder. So as I get dinking, I'm using big body parts. Also, think about keeping your finish short and abbreviated. The last thing I want to see is you guys trying to compensate with your wrist. Trying to jerk up your body. So we want our body being nice and quiet. You know, if there was a bowl on top of your head, I want you to keep that bowl there so our upper extremities are nice and still. We have good posture. We have a nice, wide, agile stance. We have that good, ready position. And we're focusing on our shoulder doing all the work here. You know, whether it's a backhand dink, whether it's a forehand dink, the paddle is connected to your shoulder and it doesn't disconnect here. Some of the natural tendencies with new players coming in is that they want to overdo their dinks. They want to add a lot of swing in. They want to squeeze too hard. So know that less is a lot more in all areas of dinking. Key mechanics are going to be, having a nice agile stance. Think about finding a stance that works for you. Some players, you know, their stance might be a bit more narrow. It might be, you know, in shoulder width. Some players who are a bit more agile might have their stance out a little bit wider, that's wider than shoulder width. But know that throughout this course, there's such a range of acceptability, so find what works for you. But as far as mechanics, we're gonna have a good ready position. We're gonna be lifting from our shoulder and using our legs. I want you pausing your paddle as you make contact, meaning right as the ball meets the paddle, I want you to keep it still, not try to compensate with your wrist. Also, think about, you know, this whole area is your semicircle. Okay, anytime that you make contact in your semicircle, you have control. Anytime that you're reaching for a ball and it's outside of your semicircle, you start losing control. I see a lot of dinks get popped up by the ball getting back behind you, the ball getting too close. Maybe you're reaching too far out and you're kind of outside of your semicircle. So a lot of dinks get popped up by using your wrist and trying to overcompensate because the ball is behind you. One of the biggest things that I see with new beginners coming in is that they have a really hard time with understanding the rules of the kitchen. Some of the myths in pickleball are you can never go in the kitchen and you can never leave the kitchen line. You should always stay on the kitchen line. Some of the things that I teach is if you want to scoot back to dink, if you want to give yourself a little bit of time, there's nothing wrong with that. And then also, the rules of the kitchen are if the ball bounces in the kitchen, you can step in. You know, let's say if there's a short dink in front of me, the easiest way to step in is lunging in and then using all that weight that's on my front foot and then lunging back. If it's a backhand, same thing. I'm gonna lunge in, use my backhand, and then step out. So don't be afraid of the kitchen. Know that you can be in the kitchen if the ball bounces. The thing you cannot do is stand in the kitchen, hovering over the net and take the ball as a volley. That is a big no-no. So don't be afraid of the kitchen. You know that a lot of good things happen at the kitchen and usually the team that is more successful, the team that controls the kitchen line better is the team that usually ends up on top. Okay, so we wanna like the kitchen. We wanna get comfortable with shuffling along the kitchen line. Know that like the best way to move in pickleball when you're at the kitchen line is crab walking or shuffling and keeping the ball inside of your semicircle. Some of the drills that we can be doing to help work on controlling our dinks could be trying to hit 10 forehand dinks together in a row on your forehand. So, you and your partner both are trying to hit forehand dinks to forehand dinks, try to get 10 in a row. If you can get 10, maybe the next week we aim for 20. But anytime you get drilling, give yourself a set number. So I think the first drill is gonna be forehand to forehand, 10 in a row. we can go backhand to backhand 10 in a row, and then we'll go body to body 10 dinks in a row. But as we get drilling, the end goal is being cooperative. So you're trying to help one another. You know, also too, you're really trying to focus on control. You're focusing on the mechanics, pushing from your shoulder, using your legs. You're not swinging too much, and then freezing your paddle at the point of contact. But those are three drills that you could be doing: is forehand to forehand, 10 in a row, backhand to backhand, and then go body to body. So those are directional dink drills. As you get drilling, if you're having a hard time directing your dinks to the correct location, you can be using a cone. If you set a cone up in between you and your partner, set your cone up about 3.5 feet inside the kitchen. The kitchen on your half is 7 feet. So 3.5 feet in is kind of like the non-attackable area. So if I'm dinking straight ahead with somebody and there's a cone 3.5 feet in, and then a cone 3.5 feet in on their side of the kitchen, we're gonna dink forehand to forehand. So he's gonna try to hit to the right side of the cone. I'm gonna try to hit to his right side of the cone. So we'll go forehand to forehand that way. And then we'll go backhand to backhand. And then a fun little game that you could do at the very end is, if you want to use one cone, it's a little tricky. If you want to use three cones, it's a lot easier. But basically, you're going to line three cones up right in front of you, parallel with the kitchen line. And you and your friend are going to try to play. And basically, you're just going to try to knock each other's cones down. You could play on a time base and say, hey, we're going to play for 2 minutes. At the end of 2 minutes, whoever knocks the most cones down is the winner. But it's just a really fun drill to focus on controlling your dinks, keeping them short, keeping them shallow, and actually trying to knock your partner's cone down. Know that all these little drills that we're doing, we can do down the line forehand to forehand dinking drills. We can do, down the line backhand to backhand, down the line body to body, then also too, we can go cross court. So make sure that anytime you drill that you're drilling down the line and you're drilling cross court. Make sure that you're drilling cross court on your dominant side and then drilling cross court on your non-dominant side. Dinking cross court gives you a lot more room. You're dinking over the lowest part of the net. You know, also too, as you get playing doubles, if you want to get your partner involved, it's really difficult to get your partner involved. If you're dinking straight ahead, obviously, because it's right in front of you, but if you dink cross court, the ball is directly in front of your partner, so it might get them more involved. So dinking cross court allows you to give yourself more room, thinking high percentage, it's lower part of the net, so you can give yourself some more margin for error. And then also too, thirdly, it's gonna get your partner involved.